And now chapter 21 of the Madhyalila, the opulence and sweetness of Lord Sri Krishna. Offering my obeisances unto Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, let me describe a particle of his opulence and sweetness. He is most valuable for a fallen conditioned soul bereft of spiritual knowledge, and he is the only shelter for those who do not know the real goal of life. All glories to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. All glories to Nityananda Prabhu. All glories to Advaitacharya. All glories to all the devotees of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu continued, "All the transcendental forms of the Lord are situated in the spiritual sky. They preside over spiritual planets in that abode, but there is no counting those Vaikuntha planets. The breadth of each Vaikuntha planet is described as 8 miles multiplied by 100, by 1,000, by 10,000, by 100,000, and by 10,000,000. In other words, each Vaikuntha planet is expanded beyond our ability to measure. Each Vaikuntha planet is very large, and each is made of spiritual bliss. The inhabitants are all associates of the Supreme Lord, and they have full opulence like the Lord Himself. Thus, they are all situated. Since all the Vaikuntha planets are located in a certain corner of the spiritual sky, who can measure the spiritual sky? The shape of the spiritual sky is compared to a lotus flower. The topmost region of that flower is called the whorl, and within that whorl is Krishna's abode. The petals of the spiritual lotus flower consist of many Vaikuntha planets. Each Vaikuntha planet is full of spiritual bliss, complete opulence, and space, and each is inhabited by incarnations. If Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva cannot estimate the length and breadth of the spiritual sky and the Vaikuntha planets, how can ordinary living entities begin to imagine them? It is said in the Srimad Bhagavatam, "O Supreme Great One, O Supreme Personality of Godhead, O Supersoul, Master of all mystic power, your pastimes are taking place continuously in these worlds, but who can estimate where, how, and when you are employing your spiritual energy and performing your pastimes? No one can understand the mystery of these activities." The spiritual qualities of Krishna are also unlimited. Great personalities like Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva, and the four Kumaras cannot estimate the spiritual qualities of the Lord. In time, great scientists may be able to count all the atoms of the universe, all the stars and planets in the sky, and all the particles of snow. But who among them can count the unlimited, transcendental qualities of the Supreme Personality of Godhead? He descends on the surface of the globe for the benefit of all living entities. To say nothing of Lord Brahma, even Lord Ananta, who has thousands of heads, could not reach the end of the Lord's transcendental qualities, even though he is continuously chanting their praises. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, Lord Brahma said to Narada Muni, "If I, Lord Brahma, and your elder brothers, the great saints and sages, cannot understand the limits of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is full of various energies, Who else can understand them? Although constantly chanting about his transcendental qualities, the thousand-hooded Lord Shesh has not yet reached the end of the Lord's activities. To say nothing of Ananta Dev, even Lord Krishna himself cannot find an end to his transcendental qualities. Indeed, he himself is always eager to know them. As it is said in the Srimad Bhagavatam, My Lord, you are unlimited. Even the predominating deities of the higher planetary systems, including Lord Brahma, could not find your limitations, nor could you yourself ascertain the limit of your qualities. Like atoms in the sky, there are multi-universes with seven coverings, and these are rotating in due course of time. All the experts in Vedic understanding are searching for you by eliminating the material elements. In this way, searching and searching, they come to the conclusion that everything is complete in you. Thus, you are the resort of everything. This is the conclusion of all Vedic experts. Apart from all argument, logic, and negative or positive processes, when Lord Sri Krishna was present as the Supreme Personality of Godhead at Vrindavan, one could not find a limit to his potencies by studying his characteristics and activities. At Vrindavan, after Lord Brahma stole the cows, calves, and cowherd boys, the Lord immediately created all material and spiritual planets in one moment. Indeed, all of them were created with their predominating deities. We do not hear of such wonderful things anywhere. Simply by hearing of those incidents, one's consciousness is agitated and cleansed. According to Shukdev Goswami, Krishna has unlimited cows and cowherd boys with him. No one could count their actual number. Each of the cowherd boys was tending calves to the extent of a koti, Arbuda, Shankha, and Padma, or millions and millions of calves. All the cowherd boys had unlimited calves. Similarly, their canes, flutes, lotus flowers, horns, garments, and ornaments were all unlimited. They cannot be limited by writing about them. The cowherd boys then became four-handed Narayans, predominating deities of Vaikuntha planets. All the separate Brahmas from different universes began to offer their prayers unto the Lords. All these transcendental bodies emanated from the body of Krishna, and within a second they all entered again into his body. When the Lord Brahma from this universe saw this pastime, he was astonished and struck with wonder. After offering his prayers, he gave the following conclusion. If someone says that he knows everything about Krishna's opulence, let him think that way. However, as far as I am concerned, with my body and mind, I consider it this way. My Lord, your opulence is like an unlimited ocean of nectar, and it is verbally and mentally impossible for me to realize even a drop of that ocean. There are people who say, I know everything about Krishna. Let them think that way. As far as I am concerned, I do not wish to speak very much about this matter. Oh, my Lord, let me say this much. As far as your opulences are concerned, they are all beyond the reach of my mind, body, and words. Let the glories of Lord Krishna be. Who could be aware of all of them? His abode, Vrindavan, has many wonderful opulences. Just try to see them all. According to the revelations of revealed scripture, Vrindavan extends only 16 kroshas, or 32 miles. Nonetheless, all the Vaikuntha planets and innumerable universes are located in one corner of this tract. No one can estimate the opulence of Krishna. That is unlimited. However, just as one sees the moon through the branches of a tree, I wish to give a little indication. While describing the transcendental opulences of Krishna, the ocean of opulence manifested in the mind of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and his mind and senses were immersed in this ocean. Thus he was perplexed. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu personally recited the following verse from the Srimad Bhagavatam, and to relish the meaning, he began to explain it himself. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, is the master of the three worlds and the three principal demigods, Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. No one is equal to or greater than him. By his spiritual potency, known as Swarajya Lakshmi, all his desires are fulfilled. While offering their dues and presents in worship, the predominating deities of all the planets touch the lotus feet of the Lord with their helmets. Thus they offer prayers to the Lord. Krishna is the original Supreme Personality of Godhead. Therefore, he is the greatest of all. No one is equal to him, nor is anyone greater than him. Krishna, known as Govinda, is the supreme controller. He has an eternal, blissful, spiritual body. He is the origin of all. He has no other origin, for he is the prime cause of all causes. The primary predominating deities of this material creation are Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva, and Lord Vishnu. Nonetheless, they simply carry out the orders of Lord Krishna, who is the master of them all. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, Lord Brahma said, "Following the will of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, I create, Lord Shiva destroys, and he himself in the form of Kshiradakshayi Vishnu maintains all the affairs of the material nature." Thus, the supreme controller of the three modes of material nature is Lord Vishnu. This is only a general description. Please try to understand another meaning of Triadisha. The three Purusha incarnations of Vishnu are the original cause of the material creation. Although Mahavishnu, Padmanabha, and Kshiradakshayi Vishnu are all shelters and controllers of the entire universe, they are nonetheless but plenary portions or portions of the plenary portions of Krishna. Therefore, he is the original personality of Godhead. The Brahma Samhita says, "The Brahmas and other lords of the mundane world appear from the pores of the Mahavishnu and remain alive for the duration of his one exhalation. I adore the primeval Lord, Govinda, for Mahavishnu is a portion of his plenary portion." This is the middle meaning. Now please hear the confidential meaning. Lord Krishna has three places of residence, which are well known from revealed scriptures. The internal abode is called Goloka Vrindavan. It is there that Lord Krishna's personal friends, associates, father and mother live. Vrindavan is the storehouse of Krishna's mercy and the sweet opulences of conjugal love. That is where the spiritual energy, working as a maidservant, exhibits the Ras dance, the quintessence of all pastimes. Vrindavan Dham is very soft due to the mercy of the Supreme Lord, and it is especially opulent due to conjugal love. The transcendental glories of the son of Maharaj Nanda are exhibited there. Under the circumstances, not the least anxiety is awakened within us. Below the Vrindavan planet is the spiritual sky, which is known as Vishnu Loka. In Vishnu Loka, there are innumerable Vaikuntha planets controlled by Narayan and other innumerable expansions of Krishna. The spiritual sky, which is full in all six opulences, is the interim residence of Lord Krishna. It is there that an unlimited number of forms of Krishna enjoy their pastimes. Innumerable Vaikuntha planets, which are just like different rooms of a treasure house, are all there, filled with all opulences. Those unlimited planets house the Lord's eternal associates, who are also enriched with the six opulences. Again, the Brahma Samhita states, below the planet named Goloka Vrindavan are the planets known as Devi Dham, Mahesh Dham, and Hari Dham. These are opulent in different ways. They are managed by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Govinda, the original Lord. I offer my obeisances unto him. And from the Padma Purana we hear, between the spiritual and material worlds is a body of water known as the river Viraja. This water is generated from the bodily perspiration of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is known as Vedanga. Thus the river flows. Beyond the river Viraja is a spiritual nature, which is indestructible, eternal, inexhaustible, and unlimited. It is the supreme abode consisting of three-fourths of the Lord's opulences. It is known as Paravyom, the spiritual sky. On the other side of the river Viraja is the external abode, which is full of unlimited universes, each containing unlimited atmospheres. The abode of the external energy is called Devi Dham, and its inhabitants are conditioned souls. It is there that the material energy, Durga, resides with many opulent maidservants. Krishna is the supreme proprietor of all dhams, including Goloka Dham, Vaikuntha Dham, and Devi Dham. The Paravyom and Goloka Dham are beyond Devi Dham, this material world. The spiritual world is considered to be three-fourths of the energy and opulence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, whereas this material world is only one-fourth of that energy. That is our understanding. Because it consists of three-fourths of the Lord's energy, the spiritual world is called Tripad Bhuta. Being a manifestation of one-fourth of the Lord's energy, the material world is called Ekapad. The three-fourths part of Lord Krishna's energy is beyond our speaking power. Let us therefore hear elaborately about the remaining one-fourth of his energy. Actually, it is very difficult to ascertain the number of universes. Every universe has its separate Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva, who are known as permanent governors. Therefore, there is also no counting of them. Once when Krishna was ruling Dvarka, Lord Brahma came to see him, and the doorman immediately informed Lord Krishna of Brahma's arrival. When Krishna was so informed, he immediately asked the doorman, "Which Brahma? What is his name?" The doorman therefore returned and questioned Lord Brahma. When the doorman asked, "Which Brahma?" Lord Brahma was surprised. He told the doorman, "Please inform Lord Krishna that I am the four-headed Brahma, who is the father of the four Kumaras." The doorman then informed Lord Krishna of Lord Brahma's description, and Lord Krishna gave him permission to enter. The doorman escorted Lord Brahma in, and as soon as Brahma saw Lord Krishna, he offered obeisances at his lotus feet. After being worshipped by Lord Brahma, Lord Krishna also honored him with suitable words. Then Lord Krishna asked him, "Why have you come here?" Being questioned, Lord Brahma immediately replied, "I shall later tell you why I have come. First of all, there is a doubt in my mind which I wish you would kindly dissipate. Why did you inquire which Brahma had come to see you? What is the purpose of such an inquiry? Is there any other Brahma besides me within this universe?" Upon hearing this, Sri Krishna smiled and immediately meditated. Then unlimited Brahmas arrived instantly. These Brahmas had different numbers of heads. Some had 10 heads, some 20, some 100, some 1,000, some 10,000, some 100,000, some 10 million, and others 100 million. No one can count the number of faces they had. There also arrived many Lord Shivas with various heads, numbering 100,000 and 10 million. Many Indras also arrived, and they had hundreds of thousands of eyes all over their bodies. When the four-headed Brahma of this universe saw all these opulences of Krishna, he became very bewildered and considered himself a rabbit among many elephants. All the Brahmas who came to see Krishna offered their respects at his lotus feet, and when they did this, their helmets touched his lotus feet. No one can estimate the inconceivable potency of Krishna. All the Brahmas who were there were resting on the one body of Krishna. When all the helmets struck together at Krishna's lotus feet, there was a tumultuous sound. It appeared that the helmets themselves were offering prayers unto Krishna's lotus feet. With folded hands, all the Brahmas and Shivas began to offer prayers unto Lord Krishna, saying, O Lord, you have shown me a great favor. I have been able to see your lotus feet. All of them then said, It is my great fortune, Lord, that you have called me, thinking of me as your servant. Now let me know what your order is, so that I may carry it on my heads. Lord Krishna replied, Since I wanted to see all of you together, I have called all of you here. All of you should be happy. Is there any fear from the demons? They replied, By your mercy, we are victorious everywhere. Whatever burden was upon the earth, you have taken away by descending on that planet. This is the proof of Dvarka's opulence. All the Brahmas thought, Krishna is now staying in my jurisdiction. Thus the opulence of Dvarka was perceived by each and every one of them. Although they were all assembled together, no one could see anyone but himself. Lord Krishna then bade farewell to all the Brahmas there, and after offering their obeisances, they all returned to their respective homes. After observing all these opulences, the four-headed Brahma of this universe was astonished. He again came before the lotus feet of Krishna and offered him obeisances. Brahma then said, Whatever I formerly decided about my knowledge, I have just now had personally verified. There are people who say, I know everything about Krishna. Let them think it in that way. As far as I am concerned, I do not wish to speak very much about this matter. Oh, my Lord, let me say this much. As far as your opulences are concerned, they are all beyond the reach of my mind, body, and words. Krishna said, Your particular universe extends 4 billion miles. Therefore, it is the smallest of all the universes. Consequently, you have only 4 heads. Some of the universes are 1 billion yojanas, some 1 trillion, some 10 trillion, and some 100 trillion yojanas. Thus, they are almost unlimited in area. And as you know, 1 yojana equals 8 miles. According to the size of the universe, there are so many heads on the body of Brahma. In this way, I maintain innumerable universes or Brahmandas. No one can measure the length and breadth of 1/4 of my energy. Who can measure the 3/4 that is manifested in the spiritual world? Beyond the river Viraja is a spiritual nature, which is indestructible, eternal, inexhaustible, and unlimited. It is the supreme abode consisting of 3/4 of the Lord's opulences. It is known as Paravyom, the spiritual sky. In this way, Lord Krishna bade farewell to the four-headed Brahma of this universe. We may thus understand that no one can calculate the extent of Krishna's energies. There is a very deep meaning in the word Triyadeshvar, which indicates that Krishna possesses three different lokas or natures. The three lokas are Gokul or Goloka, Mathura and Dvarka. Krishna lives eternally in these three places. These three places are full of internal potencies, and Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is their sole proprietor. As previously mentioned, the jewels on the helmets of all the predominating deities of all the universes and Vaikuntha planets touch the throne and the lotus feet of the Lord when they all offered obeisances. When the gems on the helmets of all the predominating deities collide before the throne and the Lord's lotus feet, there is a jingling sound which seems like prayers offered by the helmets at Krishna's lotus feet. Krishna is thus situated eternally in his spiritual potency, and the opulence of that spiritual potency is called Sad Aishvarya, indicating six kinds of opulence. Because he possesses the spiritual potencies which fulfill all his desires, Krishna is accepted as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. This is the Vedic version. The unlimited potencies of Krishna are just like an ocean of nectar. Since one cannot bathe within that ocean, I have only touched a drop of it. When Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu described the opulences and spiritual potencies of Krishna in this way, there was an awakening of love of Krishna within him. His mind was immersed in the sweetness of conjugal love, and he quoted the following verse from Srimad Bhagavatam in a conversation between Vidura and Uddhava. To exhibit the strength of his own spiritual potency, Lord Krishna manifested a suitable form just for his pastimes in the material world. This form was wonderful, even for him, and was the supreme abode of the wealth of good fortune. Its limbs were so beautiful that they increased the beauty of the ornaments worn on different parts of his body. Lord Krishna has many pastimes, of which his pastimes as a human being are the best. His form as a human being is the supreme transcendental form. In this form, he is a cowherd boy. He carries a flute in his hand, and his youth is new. He is also an expert dancer. All this is just suitable for his pastimes as a human being. My dear Sanatan, the sweet, attractive, transcendental form of Krishna is so nice. Just try to understand it. Even a fractional understanding of Krishna's beauty can merge all three worlds in an ocean of love. He attracts all the living entities within the three worlds. The transcendental form of Krishna is shown to the world by Lord Krishna's internal spiritual energy, which is a transformation of pure goodness. This jewel-like form is the most confidential treasure of the devotees. This form is manifest from Krishna's eternal pastimes. The wonder of Krishna in his personal feature is so great that it attracts even Krishna to taste his own association. Thus Krishna becomes very eager to taste that wonder. Total beauty, knowledge, wealth, strength, fame, and renunciation are the six opulences of Krishna. He is eternally situated in his opulences. Ornaments caress that body, but the transcendental body of Krishna is so beautiful that it beautifies the ornaments he wears. Therefore, Krishna's body is said to be the ornament of ornaments. Despite the wonderful beauty of Krishna, there is his three-curved style of standing, which beautifies that form. Above all these beautiful features, Krishna's eyes dance and move obliquely, acting like arrows to pierce the minds of Srimati Radharani and the gopis. When the arrow succeeds in hitting its target, their minds become agitated. The beauty of Krishna's body is so attractive that it attracts not only the demigods and other living entities within this material world, but the personalities of the spiritual sky as well, including the Narayanas, who are expansions of Krishna's personality. The minds of the Narayanas are thus attracted by the beauty of Krishna's body. In addition, the goddesses of fortune, or Lakshmis, who are wives of the Narayanas, and are the women described in the Vedas as most chaste, are also attracted by the wonderful beauty of Krishna. Favoring them, Krishna rides on the chariot of the minds of the gopis, and just to receive loving service from them, he attracts their minds like Cupid. Therefore, he is also called Madan Mohan, the attractor of Cupid. Cupid has five arrows representing form, taste, smell, sound, and touch. Krishna is the owner of these five arrows, and with his Cupid-like beauty, he conquers the minds of the gopis, though they are very proud of their super-excellent beauty. Becoming a new Cupid, Krishna attracts their minds and engages in the Ras dance. When Lord Krishna wanders in the forest of Vrindavan with his friends on an equal level, there are innumerable cows grazing. This is another of the Lord's blissful enjoyments. When he plays on his flute, all living entities, including trees, plants, animals, and human beings, tremble and are saturated with jubilation. Tears flow constantly from their eyes. Krishna wears a pearl necklace that appears like a chain of white ducks around his neck. The peacock feather in his hair appears like a rainbow, and his yellow garments appear like lightning in the sky. Krishna appears like a newly risen cloud, and the gopis appear like newly grown grains in the field. Constant rains of nectarian pastimes fall upon these newly grown grains, and it seems that the gopis are receiving beams of life from Krishna, exactly as grains receive life from the rains. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, is full in all six opulences, including his attractive beauty, which engages him in conjugal love with the gopis. Such sweetness is the quintessence of his qualities. Shukdev Goswami, the son of Vyasadeva, has described these pastimes of Krishna throughout the Srimad Bhagavatam. Hearing the descriptions, the devotees become mad with love of God. Just as the women of Mathura ecstatically describe the fortune of the gopis of Vrindavan and the transcendental qualities of Krishna, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu described the different mellows of Krishna and became overwhelmed with ecstatic love. Grasping the hand of Sanatana Goswami, he recited the following verse from the Srimad Bhagavatam, recited by the women of Mathura. What austerities must the gopis have performed? With their eyes they always drink the nectar of the face of Lord Krishna, which is the essence of loveliness, and is not to be equaled or surpassed. That loveliness is the only abode of beauty, fame, and opulence. It is self-perfect, ever fresh, and unique. The bodily beauty of Sri Krishna is like a wave in the ocean of eternal youth. In that great ocean is the whirlpool of the awakening of ecstatic love. The vibration of Krishna's flute is like a whirlwind, and the flickering minds of the gopis are like straws and dry leaves. After they fall down in the whirlwind, they never rise again, but remain eternally at the lotus feet of Krishna. O my dear friend, what severe austerities have the gopis performed to drink his transcendental beauty and sweetness through their eyes in complete fulfillment. Thus they glorify their births, bodies, and minds. The sweetness of Krishna's beauty enjoyed by the gopis is unparalleled. Nothing is equal to or greater than such ecstatic sweetness. Even the predominating deities of the Vaikuntha planets, the Narayanas, do not possess such sweetness. Indeed, none of the incarnations of Krishna up to Narayan possess such transcendental beauty. Even the dearest consort of Narayan, the goddess of fortune, who is worshipped by all chaste women, is captivated by the unparalleled sweetness of Krishna. She even gave up everything in her desire to enjoy Krishna, and taking a great vow, she underwent severe austerities. The quintessence of Krishna's sweet bodily luster is so perfect that there is no perfection above it. He is the immutable mine of all transcendental qualities. In his other manifestations and personal expansions, there is only a partial exhibition of such qualities. We understand all his personal expansions in this way. Both the gopis and Krishna are complete. The gopis' ecstatic love is like a mirror that becomes newer and newer at every moment, and reflects Krishna's bodily luster and sweetness. Thus competition increases. Since neither give up, their pastimes become newer and newer, and both sides constantly increase. The transcendental mellows generated from the dealings between the gopis and Krishna cannot be tasted by fruitive activity, yogic austerities, speculative knowledge, regulative devotional service, mantra yoga, or meditation. This sweetness can be tasted only through the spontaneous love of liberated persons who chant the holy names with great ecstatic love. Such ecstatic transactions between Krishna and the gopis are only possible in Vrindavan, which is full of the opulences of transcendental love. The form of Krishna is the original source of all transcendental qualities. It is like a mine of gems. The opulence belonging to all the personal expansions of Krishna are to be understood to be bestowed by Krishna. Therefore, Krishna is the original source and shelter of everyone. Beauty, humility, mercy, merit, patience, and expert intelligence are all manifest in Krishna. Besides these, Krishna has other qualities like good behavior, mildness, and magnanimity. He also performs welfare activities for the whole world. All these qualities are not visible in expansions like Narayan. After seeing Krishna, various people criticize the blinking of their eyes. In Vrindavan especially, all the gopis criticize Lord Brahma because of this defect in the eyes. Then Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu recited some verses from Srimad Bhagavatam and explained them vividly, thus enjoying the taste of transcendental sweetness with great happiness. He quoted, "All men and women were accustomed to enjoying the beauty of the shining face of Lord Krishna, as well as his shark-like earrings swinging on his ears. His beautiful features, his cheeks, and his playful smiles all combined to form a constant festival for the eyes. and the blinking of the eyes became obstacles that impeded one from seeing that beauty. For this reason, men and women became very angry at the Creator, Lord Brahma. O Krishna, when you go to the forest during the day, and we do not see your sweet face, which is surrounded by beautiful curling hair, half a second becomes as long as an entire age for us. And we consider the Creator, who has put eyelids on the eyes we use for seeing you, to be simply a fool. Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is identical with the Vedic hymn known as the Karma Gayatri, which is composed of 24.5 syllables. Those syllables are compared to moons that arise in Krishna. Thus, all three worlds are filled with desire. The face of Krishna is the king of all moons, and the body of Krishna is the throne. Thus, the king governs a society of moons. Krishna has two cheeks that shine like glowing gems. Both are considered full moons. His forehead is considered a half moon, and his spots of sandalwood are considered full moons. His fingernails are many full moons, and they dance on the flute on his hands. Their song is the melody of that flute. His toenails are also many full moons, and they dance on the ground. Their song is the jingling of his ankle bells. Krishna's face is the enjoyer king. That full moon face makes his shark-shaped earrings and lotus eyes dance. His eyebrows are like bows, and his eyes are like arrows. His ears are fixed on the string of that bow, and when his eyes spread to his ears, he pierces the hearts of the gopis. The dancing features of his face surpass all other full moons and expand the marketplace of full moons. Although priceless, the nectar of Krishna's face is distributed to everyone. Some purchase the moon rays of his sweet smiles, and others purchase the nectar of his lips. Thus he pleases everyone. Krishna has two reddish, widely spread eyes. These are ministers of the king, and they subdue the pride of Cupid, who also has beautiful eyes. That face of Govinda, which is full of happiness, is the home of the pastimes of beauty, and it is very pleasing to everyone's eyes. If by devotional service one gets the results of pious activities, and sees Lord Krishna's face, he can relish the Lord with his eyes. His greed and thirst then increase twofold by seeing the nectarian face of Krishna. Due to one's inability to sufficiently drink that nectar, one becomes very unhappy and criticizes the Creator for not having given more than two eyes. When the onlooker of Krishna's face becomes dissatisfied in this way, he thinks, "Why didn't the Creator give me thousands and millions of eyes? Why has He given me only two? Even these two eyes are disturbed by blinking, which keeps me from continuously seeing Krishna's face." Thus one accuses the Creator of being dry and tasteless due to engaging in severe austerities. The Creator is only a dry manufacturer. He does not know how to create and set things in their proper places. The Creator says, "Let those who will see Krishna's beautiful face have two eyes." Just see the lack of consideration exhibited by this person posing as a creator. If the Creator took my advice, He would give millions of eyes to the person who intends to see Krishna's face. If the Creator will accept this advice, then I would say that He is competent in His work. The transcendental form of Lord Sri Krishna is compared to an ocean. A particularly extraordinary vision is the moon above that ocean, and another vision is His smile, which is sweeter than sweet, and is like shining beams of moonlight. While speaking of these things with Sanatan Goswami, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu began to remember one thing after another. Moving his hands in ecstasy, he recited a verse from the Krishna Karnamrita. He said, O my Lord, the transcendental body of Krishna is very sweet, and His face is even sweeter than His body. The soft smile on His face, which is like the fragrance of honey, is sweeter still. My dear Sanatan, the sweetness of Krishna's personality is just like an ocean of ambrosia. Although my mind is now afflicted by convulsive diseases from seeing Krishna's beauty, and I wish to drink that entire ocean, the repressive physician, Krishna Himself, does not allow me to drink even one drop. Krishna's body is a city of attractive features, and it is sweeter than sweet. His face, which is like the moon, is sweeter still, and the gentle smile on that moon-like face is like rays of moonshine. The beauty of Krishna's smile is the sweetest feature of all. His smile is like a full moon that spreads its rays throughout the three worlds, Goloka Vrindavan, the spiritual sky of the Vaikunthas, and Devidam, the material world. Thus Krishna's shining beauty spreads in all 10 directions. His slight smiling and fragrant illumination are compared to camphor, which enters the sweetness of the lips. That sweetness is transformed and enters into space as vibrations from the holes of His flute. The sound of Krishna's flute spreads in 4 directions. Even though Krishna vibrates His flute within this universe, its sound pierces the universal covering and goes to the spiritual sky. Thus the vibration enters the ears of all inhabitants. It especially enters Goloka Vrindavan Dham and attracts the minds of the young damsels of Vrajabhumi, bringing them forcibly to where Krishna is present. The vibration of Krishna's flute is very aggressive, and it breaks the vows of all chaste women. Indeed, its vibration takes them forcibly from the laps of their husbands. The vibration of His flute attracts even the goddess of fortune in the Vaikuntha planets, to say nothing of the poor damsels of Vrindavan. The vibration of His flute slackens the knots of their underwear, even in front of their husbands. Thus, the gopis are forced to abandon their household duties and come before Lord Krishna. In this way, all social etiquette, shame, and fear are vanquished. The vibration of His flute causes all women to dance. The vibration of His flute is just like a bird that creates a nest within the ears of the gopis, and always remains prominent there, not allowing any other sound to enter their ears. Indeed, the gopis cannot hear anything else, nor are they able to concentrate on anything else, not even to give a suitable reply. Such are the effects of the vibration of Lord Krishna's flute. Resuming his external consciousness, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told Sanatan Goswami, "I have not spoken of what I intended. Lord Krishna is very merciful to you, because by bewildering my mind, he has exposed his personal opulence and sweetness. He has caused you to hear all these things from me for your understanding. Since I have become a madman, I am saying one thing instead of another. This is because I am being carried away by the waves of the nectarine ocean of Lord Krishna's transcendental sweetness." Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then remained silent for a moment. Finally, adjusting things within his mind, he again spoke to Sanatan Goswami. "I now summarize these teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. If anyone gets an opportunity to hear about the sweetness of Krishna in this chapter of Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, he will certainly be eligible to float in the transcendentally blissful ocean of love of God." Praying at the lotus feet of Sri Rupa and Sri Raghunath, always desiring their mercy, I, Krishnadas, narrate Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, following in their footsteps. This ends chapter 21 of the Madhya Lila, the opulence and sweetness of Krishna.